Praise the Lord, God's children, because this is a day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. Welcome to the Master's Word. I'm your host, Dr. Stefeni. Now, my friends, all Master's Word programs are Christian internet radio and TV talk shows, and they're directed at educating, edifying, and helping the body of Christ to gain understanding of God's Word and to know just who they are in Christ. So, good morning. Let's pray. Father, we come into your presence with praise and thanksgiving in our hearts, overflowing our lips. We praise you, we love you, and we thank you, Lord, for all that you've done and are doing. We adore you, we thank and praise you that we can seek you, and you'll always illuminate your word so that we can gain the proper understanding of it. And we thank you for the Rhema word of God, the Logos word, and for impartation and revelation knowledge, for the gift of utterance and the manifestation of your word always alive and active in our hearts. Bless those that have ears to hear, Lord, as we endeavor to know you more personally and love you more deeply. Holy Spirit, we invite you to take over this broadcast right now, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. You know, my friends, if you didn't come expecting to receive from God today, then you won't receive anything from him. So elevate your expectation level, and you will come away with a greater head and heart connection and knowledge and a better understanding of God's word. Now, we're moving into things more deeply in the word of God, and each time we meet, we're doing that. And so we have to do something just a bit extra to gain entrance into that specific depth of God. So we've found that the key to that depth is soaking in worship. So soak with me right now. As we continue on with our study of the mind of Christ, we're delving further into developing wisdom. Now, we've talked about wisdom being progressive, and we've seen that there are different rivers of wisdom. We've looked into them. We've also touched on the music and the melody and the harmonies of God and how they interact with our being in relation to our developing wisdom. Now, we found that wisdom and intelligence can both be developed. However, there are certain conditions that are necessary for that to take place. The Bible calls praising and worshiping God and giving thanks His will. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 says this, "In everything give thanks, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you." So our spirit must be positioned correctly, and then when it is, we're going to tap into the wisdom of God. We found in our study that music seems to impart quietness to our physical body, and when your body sleeps and rests, your body goes into a regular rhythm. So when you relax with gospel music, what happens? Your body responds in a harmonious way with God's rhythm and harmony. So we need to enter that into that spiritual rest that God promised us. Hebrews 4:1 says, "Therefore, since a promise remains of entering his rest, let us fear lest any of you seem to have come short of it. For indeed, the gospel was preached to us as well as to them. But the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. For we who have believed do enter that rest, as he has said." Now the Bible's talking here about the Israelites who didn't enter the rest. Moses told them to enter, but they didn't enter because they believed the 10 spies who were giving the bad report. So they didn't go into the promised land. Why? Because they had unbelief in their hearts. They didn't have faith in their hearts, and they didn't enter the promised land. Joshua led a whole new group of Israelites into the promised land. Now we see that wisdom is not an it's a person, the person of Jesus the Christ. And when we rest in Christ, then suddenly the river of wisdom starts flowing in our hearts and minds. When did it begin? It began when we got synchronized physically in music, and it brought us to that point and that position of rest. It's very powerful. Today, we're going to focus on wisdom and tongues. Luke chapter 2, I sense this is going to be kind of a short message, but we're going to look at Luke chapter 2. What we're doing is considering the mind of Jesus, and we want to follow the development of that mind because the Bible does tell us that we are to have the same mind that Jesus has, and God wants us to have a perfect mind. So it's not going to be an instant thing, folks, but it's going to be a gradual process, and you can tell as you walk with God that something's happening on the inside, besides our spirit being born again and becoming a new creature in Christ. So something's happening to our soul, to our intellect, to our emotions, to our mind, and to our will. As I look back, I say, God, I can't even recognize myself. And I know, God, that in continuing my walk with you, that I'm going to change even more. I'm not going to be that same person that I was last year, the year next year. I'm not going to be that same person as I am this year, because my mind is different and some quickening has begun as I begin to grow in the Word and the principles of God's Word. Okay. Now, the Bible makes a statement about our Lord Jesus Christ when he went back to stay with his parents after the incident at the temple. Luke 2, verse 51. "Then he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was subject to them. But his mother kept all these things in her heart, and Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and with men." The word wisdom is expressed here immediately after the incident at the temple. So let's read the incident also, so you're brought to speed. In verse 47, this speaks to us, being tied up to his understanding and his heart. Verse 47, "And all who heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers." That's us, right? Aren't we astonished when God does something for us or with us? Well, this statement was made when his mother came and found him there in the temple. And there are several Greek words for the word understanding, but there are three primary Greek words for the word understanding. One that you're the most likely familiar with will be by now, of course, because I harp on it all the time, is the word dianoia. Spelled D-I-A-N-O-I-A, it looks like dianoia, but it's pronounced dianoia, which is used in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17, that talks about the imagination part of our mind. The other one is the one that Paul used in 1 Corinthians 14, verses 14 through 15, when he says, "I pray with my spirit, my understanding is unfruitful," when I pray with my spirit. And what is it then? Well, it says, "I will pray with my spirit and I will pray with my understanding." Now, Paul uses a different Greek word for the word understanding in 1 Corinthians 14. He used the word nous, N-O-U-S, which is in our study on the mind. And we've spoken about how that refers to the conscious part of our mind, remember? That's about 5% of your whole intellect and mind. So the word nous refers to the conscious part of our mind, the understanding. Now, here in Luke chapter 2, when they talked about how they were astonished at his understanding and how he grew in wisdom, the word understanding is a special Greek word. It's the Greek word sunesis. The word sunesis is a very unusual word for understanding, mainly because the word sunesis doesn't have any logical connection with the word mind. If you examine it closely, you'll see this. See, it comes from the word sun, S-U-N, which means to be gathered with. The word synagogue comes from the word sun, to be gathered with. The Greek word is synagogue, and what comes from that word is the word synagogue. From the word sun, to be gathered together with, it talks about gathering together. So then it talks about synesis, and then the word nesis is reference to a collection of something, anything. So if you put both together, it refers to a collection, and for some translations like the Young's, they interpret the word synesis as a compilation, a collection together, and that's all. They leave it hanging. A compilation together of what? Well, of course, we understand it as a full comprehension, an ability to gather a full scope of all data together at once. So that's the special word for understanding that's used. Now, that word, understanding, is relevant to the spiritual realm. I prayed and said, God, the word synesis seems to point to a person more than to a thing. The word son, if you study the Greek word, is used more for gathering of people, and it has a sense of a personality involved, to be gathered together with. So it seems to talk more about a gathering of people than just things. And as I examined it very closely and reflected over all those things that I've been teaching and touching on here, there came this echo from the truth that resounded from heaven, like the voice of God saying, wisdom is not a thing, it's not a force, and it never was or is. But wisdom has always been determined by God to be a person. I realize, God, that wisdom is a person. The word logos that I used in the Greek, or not I used, but that is used in the Greek in reference to Jesus in John chapter 1, verse 1, says, in the beginning was the logos, and the logos was with God, and the logos was God. They don't treat the logos as it as a force. John's referring to the logos as a person, and in fact as God. Now, if we had a Greek mind, and we lived in Paul's time and John's time, as we read the epistle in the Greek, assuming we were fluent in the New Testament Greek, and if we read the scriptures in the original language as it was written, this would have been the understanding of what the word logos is. In the beginning was the logos, and the logos was with God, and the logos was God. Now, the word logos is the understanding of the Greek mind, and it symbolizes the principal force and the principal wisdom. We would then read it in this way. In the beginning was wisdom, and wisdom was with God, and wisdom was God. It confirms it. Proverbs says wisdom is the principal thing. It's the principal force, and we realize that a person can have a force, but a force may not be a person. Wisdom is a person. You couldn't separate the wisdom of God from its personality. If you read the epistle of 1 John, there are two strong statements made. One is God is light, and in this teaching we're going to consider that light represents wisdom. The other one is God is love, and when you use it, the word is, when you use the word is, it's actually possible to reverse it, and it will still be true. God is love. And then I'm talking about God's kind of love, and then love is God. God is light, and the only true light is God, and that confirms what John chapter 1 is talking about. Let's look at John 1. He says that there is only one light in the whole universe, and that light, he points to in John 1:4, talking about the logos, the wisdom, the supreme idea, the supreme principle idea. Listen to this. In him was life, and the life was the light of men, and the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. Okay, so wisdom is life, is light, is logos, and all these are tied up together. Now, as we consider the wisdom of God in the mind of Jesus Christ, the mind of Jesus Christ remains the mind of Jesus Christ. In other words, the only way we can tap into that mind is to have a relationship with him. So it's not considered like the mind, a piece of the mind that you can cut off, put it aside or inside of you, and then you have it. The whole key to the mind of Christ is relationship with God, being related to him. Now, Jesus showed us the example when he was on the earth in the book of Philippians, chapter 2, verses 4 through 11. Let's look at it. Let each of you look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of others. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who, being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Therefore, God also had highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and of those on earth and of those under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The one statement he made here is in verse 5, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Now, it's a particularly peculiar type of mind, because in verse 3, as he introduced this subject, he says, let nothing be done to selfish ambition or conceit. He calls it here in lowliness of mind. What is lowliness of mind? Well, he goes on to talk about how Jesus has this lowliness of mind. Have you ever heard the statement that is often made that says he has a mind of his own? Sometimes that's used in reference to kids, children. They have a mind of their own. What do I mean? Well, I mean that individual is independent of whosoever or whatsoever. Okay. When Adam and Eve fell into sin, they not only chose sin, they chose to have a mind of their own. They chose a mind that would function and make its own decisions separated from God. God says, don't eat the fruit of that tree of knowledge of good and evil. But Adam ate it. Why? Because he was given it to eat. Eve ate it because she was tricked into eating it. But the doing of it, the actual partaking of that fruit, they made the decision to do it. So lowliness of mind is the surrender of our mind. That's in 1 Corinthians chapter 2. We have to approach this subject, my friends, very cautiously, because we're not talking about being mindless zombies here. Yet at the same time, we're not advocating that we have an independent mind separated from God. There is a balance between the two. On the one side is a passive mind. God doesn't advocate a passive mind. That reduces us to zombies. God's not asking for robot-like obedience, where we don't think anymore. On the other hand, it's definitely unscriptural and disobedient to surpass or think that we can go against God's principles, you see, because God's ideas or God's word won't allow it, just because we think we know more than God, without realizing that God's thoughts are higher than our thoughts. See what I mean? So one side is a prideful mind, independent of God, saying, God, I don't need you. I can do this on my own power and strength. And I can think it out for myself. Now, somewhere between those extremes is a state of mind called lowliness of mind. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 is talking about wisdom and the mind of Christ. And in verses 1 through 4, it says, and I, brethren, when I came to you, did not come with the excellence of speech or with wisdom declaring to you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I was with you in weakness, in fear, and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. Verse 6, however, we speak wisdom among those who are mature, yet not the wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God ordained before the ages of our glory. Wow, that it says here, that the wisdom was planned, was ordained by God before the world was made. God determined that we'd have that special wisdom that comes from him. What is that talking about? Well, the person of Jesus Christ. The day God made the world, God determined that all things would flow to that second person of the Godhead. And it says in Ephesians chapter 1, before the foundation of the world, God has chosen us in Christ to be conformed to his image. All right now. The person of Jesus Christ, it says in him, is the fullness of God. He is the Logos of God. All the wisdom of God from the Alpha to the Omega, all that he is, he was, and is to come, has been placed or deposited in the person of Jesus Christ. And that person of Jesus Christ is the source and the key behind all of our wisdom. And that's why 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30 says this, but of him you are in Christ, but of him, capital H, but of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God. Okay, so here again, you see wisdom as a person. Every time you see the word wisdom mentioned, you can tie it back to a person. For wisdom is a person. It's not just a force. It is a force, but above that, it's a person. What is a person? A person is someone who speaks, who functions separately from us, who has a personality, a voice, a mind, and emotions. Wisdom in the book of Proverbs was personified as crying out in the streets. Wisdom is a person. It's the relationship that we need to have. God has never intended wisdom to be separated from the person. There is no possibility of having wisdom separated from the person who is wisdom. because God never considered wisdom a thing. It's just like a person who has finances. He can easily pass to me some finances, say $50, and that $50 becomes separated from his person. I can take it and buy something with it, but he can't pass me his hand, because if I take his hand, it's no longer a hand that can be used. He can't cut it off and give it to me. It becomes a dead hand. So he can pass me his substance, and it can separate from his person, but it can't separate his body from him. So if I want his hand, then his whole body has to follow with it. Get it? God has determined that his wisdom is like the hand of Jesus. You can never have his wisdom without having him, the whole person. When Adam and Eve fell into sin, they thought they could have the wisdom of good and evil. Do you remember what they wanted? What did the devil tell them through the serpent? There was the tree of knowledge of good and evil. The tree is the fruit of knowledge and evil. The devil said, through the serpent, now, eat the fruit and you'll be wise. Do you know that the first sin that happened was because someone wanted to be wise without God? The serpent said, you would be wise like God if you eat the fruit. No, God said not to eat it. Did God really say that? No, God knows that if you eat it, you'll be wise like him. So what was the actual temptation there? Anyone have any idea? Think about it. The temptation was you could be like him, so you don't need him. That's what the devil was saying through the serpent. You can be just like him, so you can do without him. Wisdom without God was the temptation. Now, we know the whole story. Eve took it, ate it, and passed it to Adam. Adam ate it, and here's where we're struggling along. But the fact is that the same temptation still happens, only in a different way, in different places to different people. Get this, the greatest temptation besides the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life is to have wisdom without God, independence without God. There is no liberty except where the spirit of liberty is. Any liberty without the spirit of liberty is slavery to sin. That's behind the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. Behind it all is having your own way, having your own ideas. Now, I'm teaching you about the mind of Christ here, and we have to balance it in this message, because otherwise we may end up so puffed up that we forget wisdom is a person. We think we are the very intelligent, we think that we're just super intelligent because of our IQ. And maybe our IQ is above 200, or perhaps we have had some success in something. And the world loves you when you succeed. The world will renounce you when you fail. And what happens is sometimes we get a hold of some success, and then we make a big issue out of it. And we start moving away from dependence on God. That's when we get into trouble. You know, there's a story in the Bible in Joshua's time, how they fought with the people in Jericho. And it was really very simple and easy. All they had to do was follow God's instruction, which they did. Now, God said, for 7 days, you'll march around that city. And the first 6 days, you march around completely once. The seventh day, you march around seven times. And then, when you complete it, then shout. They followed God's instruction, and they succeeded gloriously. In the city of Ai, some people who had fought and won said, we are strong. Now watch what's happening. Now we don't need to send so many, as we are expert warriors. Joshua 7 verse 3 says this, do not let all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and attack Ai. Do not weary all the people there, for the people of Ai are few. They lost the battle. That wasn't God's idea. That was their own idea. Ideas are the essence of God's will given to us. Wrong ideas are breeding grounds for sin and failure. Now, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 2 that the wisdom he spoke was not his, but it was of God and from God. In verse 10, God has revealed them to us through his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of man except the Spirit of man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. So here again, you see that wisdom is a person. You never isolate wisdom from a person. It's not just a thing or a force, but it's a person. So if wisdom is a person, then the key to wisdom is not education, it's relationship. If wisdom was just a thing, then the key would be in other realms. But because wisdom is a person, the only way to be wise is to relate to the person of wisdom and keep a close relationship. You see, God doesn't just desire to give us counsel. He wants to come and remain and be the ever-living counselor in our lives. God doesn't want just to give us healing. He wants to come into our lives and be the ever-present healer. God wants us, doesn't want us to just have a portion of his nature, but he wants to come down and say, I want to dwell in them and be in them. Now, the goal of God is that he will be in relationship with us. Since wisdom is a person, we need to learn to relate to him, which Paul says this. Number one, love him. He says that the eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor has it entered into the heart of men, the things which God has reserved for those who love him. The conclusion would be, without love, there is no wisdom from God, and it's not any ordinary love. Now, I've found out that love has a price. God so loved the world that it cost him his son. Take on the humanity of a man to die on the cross for us. We need that when David loves God, see? Or, I mean, not we need it, but we see it. We see that when David loves God, he wants his love to have a cost. He doesn't want to love God cheaply. So when God forgave him and pardoned him and showed him mercy after he had numbered the Israelites against God's advice, the plague spread all over, and he was in the field of one Arunah, the Jebusite, and the angel of the Lord raised his sword to destroy Jerusalem, and God said, stop. David was so grateful he wanted to bring a burnt offering to God. So he wanted the piece of land where the plague stopped to mark his love and gratefulness for the mercy of God. And the owner said, David, you can have it. Take it. It's free. It's for you. It's yours. Just free. And David said, oh, no. I wouldn't bring to God an offering that I didn't pay for, so I can take the land because it wouldn't have cost me something. Or I can't take the land because it wouldn't have cost me something. See, David loves God. The reference here is 2 Samuel chapter 24. So there's too many people who want to worship God without a cost. There's no such thing as a love without a cost. If you love someone with God's love, it'll cost you. The world has a kind of love of convenience. You know, think about when you get married to somebody. And let's look at the love of God in us and how it costs us. When you get married to someone, you love that person and everything is great. And then suddenly you have to make a sacrifice. You have to give up a part of yourself, a part of your independence to become dependent. You have to humble yourself before the other person. That's a God kind of love. And it costs you something. It costs you a piece of yourself. And this marriage, as it goes along and grows, may cost you a lot more than just one piece of yourself. You may find yourself giving more of yourself than the other one gives back to you. But you must, because that's God's kind of love. But what the world has is a kind of love of convenience, as I said. And that's why a lot of relationships have been broken, because they are steeped in selfishness. True love means it's a sacrificial love. There's something that's been sacrificed. So Paul says, eye has not seen nor ear heard the things that God has for those who would love him. That you are willing to part with a great portion of your time, your substances, and everything else just to be with God. That's the important thing. Paul continues in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 13. These things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. So you see, Jesus did not send us a teaching. He sent us a teacher, the Holy Spirit. He didn't just send us the truth in a book, but he sent us the person of the Holy Spirit. It's a personal, intimate relationship with the person of the Holy Spirit, which is Christ, the Spirit of Jesus, and through the person of the Holy Spirit, the Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all wisdom. You see, wisdom is a person. Then he says in verse 16, who has known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. Now he relates the mind of Christ with wisdom, with understanding. And now we understand why he uses the Greek word synesis. Why? Because the word synesis talks about a gathering together with. Now I found that it's not just a gathering together of facts, but also a gathering together with a person. Every time you're connected to the person, synesis operates. In all of our lives, the Holy Spirit has always been with us as a person, but we don't communicate with him and we don't talk with him. We don't talk to the Lord Jesus Christ as a person. We talk to human beings. We should learn to cultivate a relationship with him where we can draw from his mind. You know, when I first got a hold of this years ago, right after I got born again, about having a relationship with Christ, and I said to myself, self, how do you develop that? And what came to my mind was, it was almost as if God was speaking to me, through me, when I spoke to myself, and I said, well, you know what? I have to develop a relationship with him. And what I have to do then is imagine him being with me all the time, everywhere I am. When I'm driving, he was in the passenger seat with me, where I could talk to him. And I would converse with him out loud, just as if he were sitting there answering me. And then when I started learning to drive on the freeway, because I was a late bloomer when in driving, and I didn't want to get on the freeway. But when I had to drive on the freeway, I had fear. So I said, okay, Lord, I see you driving for me today. You drive and I'll sit in the passenger seat. Now, I couldn't physically get over there, as you know. So I would imagine myself moving over into the passenger seat, and he sat down where I was and he took a hold of the wheel. And I would go along like that driving, but I would imagine him driving. Then I decided that that was still a separate relationship and it couldn't be like that. It had to be one. We were one flesh, one entity, because I was born through Jesus Christ when I was born again, which made me bone of his bone, flesh of his flesh. So I can't continually move myself away from him. I have to keep me fused together with him. So then I got to where I would sit in the driver's seat before I'd go leave for work or whatever. I would pray over my car, over myself, over everything. And then I would see myself, Christ coming down over the top of me and me putting my arms through his and my hands into his hands, taking a hold of the wheel. And I would talk to him just as if he was a passenger, but I saw him where I was seated in, and I was in him. That's how I began to develop through my imagination, through my dhyana. God was speaking to me and showing me how to make myself a part of him, have a relationship with him so that I could draw from his mind. You see? So his mind remains his mind, but through time, as we understand his mind and we begin to think like his mind, then we will become more and more like him. And his mind is still his mind, and he lives in us. Synesis means a tying up together with, a relating together with that person of the Holy Spirit, and through him, the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the spirit of truth is the spirit of wisdom. Truth and wisdom are one, for all wisdom is truth, and all truth contains wisdom. So the other word that he expressed is the word that we find in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 7, the word mystery. In verse 7, it says, we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery. The Greek word for mystery, mysterion, speaks about something that's uncommon. It's something that is reserved only for when you are initiated. In other words, there is a price to pay before that comes to you. There is initiation process, a ceremony that takes place in mystery. Now, again, it ties back to that relationship. So out of the relationship, I relate to God and he welcomes me into the realm of mystery. To the people outside looking in, it's mysterious. To you looking out from the mystery, you understand it. That is synesis. And we'll pick up again here on Thursday. And I'm led to believe right now that the Lord is putting an unction on my heart to repeat this message again before we go on. So I may be doing that Thursday, or I may be tweaking it a little bit, giving you a little more insight. I think you need a better explanation, maybe go a little slower with it. So I think what we'll do is we'll repeat this same message and we'll pick up here on Thursday. So did you receive this today? I pray that you did. If you need further explanation of the message or understanding of it, please contact me. MasterstouchHS@Cox.net. MasterstouchHS@Cox.net. Now, following this program, we have the Master's Touch Master Class. And then following that program, we have this program that the Lord gave me recently. It's fairly new. We've done maybe five of them or six of them now on Holy Communion. You know, I found that the body of Christ, the church, more often than not, takes Holy Communion without a thought to what it truly means, what it does, without knowing what the effects of Holy Communion are. It's not just something we do as a ritual. We all know that if we don't understand something, we don't get the good from it, right? Well, the Holy Spirit's led me to bring this program on Holy Communion to you every Monday at 10 a.m. right here on Spreaker.com, and that's Pacific time, by the way, West Coast. So we're delving deeply into Holy Communion, what it is, its importance in our lives, why we partake, and what to expect from having partaken of it. Be sure to join us every Monday for Holy Communion, and this will definitely have an impact on your life, my friends. Now, for a full programming schedule, please visit our website homepage, www.themasterstouch.org. That's themasterstouch.org. Brethren, Proverbs 4, verse 7 tells us this: wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and with all of your getting, get understanding. That's exactly what we're doing here, my friends, seeking for and gaining God's wisdom. So make sure you're keeping Jesus Lord of your life. Okay. The Master's Word is a subsidiary of the Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International. We're a 501c3 organization. Have a blessed and wonderful week, and we'll see you again for the Master's Word on Thursday morning at 8 a.m. God bless you.